sponsored by Surfshark VPN. Just 2 years ago, the Planet of the Humans documentary shot renewables in the face, to the point that one of the interviewees, Ozzie Zenner, said about renewables and recycling, "You would have been better off just burning fossil fuels to begin with." I get countless comments on my videos calling various topics like EVs, wind turbines, solar panels, battery tech, you name it, they call them scams or not possible, or that it's been debunked. Debunking is nothing new. History tells us that many technologies were debunked and said to be failures before they went on to change the world. Let's take a look at why we love to hate things and five examples of technological advancements that proved the naysayers wrong. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. There's a steady stream of skepticism and debunking that comes up around solar panels, wind turbines, battery storage, electric vehicles, you name it. Tesla has been doomed to fail since they first began selling cars. Every time a lightbulb moment goes off in an innovator's mind, there are many others that are trying to switch it off. Demanding scientific evidence is fair enough, but sometimes the excess of disbelief is a little out of control. Now, there are five great examples of this from the history of technology, but before we get into those, what drives all of this? Well, there's such a thing as a sort of creativity paradox. We like creative ideas, but at the same time, we're really scared of them. That's pretty much the outcome of a study conducted by the University of Pennsylvania on more than 200 people back in 2010. Researchers found novel ideas promote a sense of uncertainty that makes most people uncomfortable. To add to that, objective evidence supporting a new concept wasn't enough to avoid rejection from most of the study's participants. Sound familiar? So what's causing it? Based on their tests, scientists unveiled an unconscious bias that led people to reject novel and high-quality products. But there's another interesting thing that researchers concluded. We might not be aware of our hostile behavior against those creative ideas, and that's undermining our capacity to even recognize them. Now, I don't know about you, but that makes me feel a little uncomfortable. Now, keeping yourself in a sweet spot between skepticism and open-mindedness should be the ideal balance, but it might be more tricky than you think. The main takeaway is that a naysayer attitude can make us reject something valuable. And it's not just science saying that. History does too. And before you start typing away in the comment box to debunk this, let's dive into five inventions that people label as a scam when they originally came out. Number one, alternating current. The development of alternating current power systems was definitely one of the major breakthroughs of the 20th century. While AC had already been invented before his time, Nikola Tesla refined the technology and made it more practical. His creative genius sparked when he was still a student at Joanneum Polytechnic School in Graz, Austria. Observing a dynamo converting alternating current into direct current, the Serbian-American inventor told his teacher he could tweak the mechanism to get rid of the commutator. Now, while Tesla's instructor burst into laughter, Nikola was already envisioning what became his famous polyphase induction motor in 1887. Instead of using a commutator to reverse the current direction, Tesla's system used multiple ACs to create a magnetic field. This induced a current that turned the motor. His teacher wasn't the only one to criticize his ideas. He was often ridiculed by the energetic critics on behalf of his main opponent, Thomas Edison, who had a bit of an agenda when it came to Tesla. The father of direct current thought that fooling around with alternating current is just a waste of time. Nobody will use it, ever. Now, clearly Edison was biased, and not just unconsciously, but that was just the onset of the war of currents. Besides making fun of his rival's intuition, Edison built up the tension even more, sponsoring public demonstrations to throw mud on AC. He tried to terrorize people, touting AC as something as dangerous as an electric chair. And Tesla wasn't his only target. Edison charged Westinghouse, the entrepreneur investing in the AC system, with attempted murder. Westinghouse will kill a customer within 6 months after he puts in a system of any size. To prove his point on the AC safety risk, Edison also filmed the electrocution of an animal in a public zoo. However, despite the harsh resistance, AC won the heated battle. Being able to convert power voltage and carry it over long distances with minimal losses, the AC system paved the way for the electrification of homes and buildings around the world. But before I get into the second invention, I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. Now, I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking. A VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job of blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This could come in handy if you want to stream a video if it's only available from a specific location. One of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off, plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to the second invention. Number 2 is airplanes. Everything's hard at the beginning, right? Anyway, in 1901, after a few unsuccessful trials, the pioneer of aircrafts, Wilbur Wright, debunked himself, saying, "Man will not fly for 50 years. Uplifted by those words, the director of the U.S. Naval Observatory chimed in, proclaiming, "Flight by machines heavier than air is impractical and insignificant, if not utterly impossible." Yet Wright disproved his own words and everyone else's just 2 years later, when flying the world's first heavier-than-air craft over Kitty Hawk in North Carolina with his brother. But the flying duo had to fight against other skeptics. A year after their historic flight, public opinion still didn't trust the invention, and the Scientific American magazine demanded more down-to-earth proof. The lack of trust in airplanes was fueled by reputable scientists as well, like Professor Newcomb, who wrote an article just 2 months before the Wright brothers' flight. The scientists argued that even if anybody managed to fly, it would be impossible to stop without crashing. Now, clearly, he was wrong, but believable given the physics knowledge of the time. The renowned astronomer William H. Pickering, who worked at the Harvard College Observatory, was one of the last to hop on the anti-flying bandwagon, stating that, "It is clear that with our present devices, there is no hope of aircraft competing for racing speed with either our locomotives or automobiles." Things quickly shifted despite the critics with the beginning of World War I, when governments began spending money on air forces. The conflict then paved the runway for air travel to flourish. In 2019, the world's airlines performed 38.9 million flights. Could you imagine not being able to fly? Now, number 3 is space travel. At the beginning of the 20th century, the Russian scientist Konstantin Tsiolkovsky envisioned that humans could explore space using rockets. As you can probably guess by now, you can see where I'm going with this. His farsighted theories gained a good amount of laughs. There was plenty of space for skeptics to discount Tsiolkovsky's idea, like Lee DeForest did in 1920. When talking about space travel, the American inventor said, "I am bold enough to say that such a man-made voyage will never occur, regardless of all future advances." That held up well. Now, even though the New York Times had its say on the topic, a rocket will never be able to leave the Earth's atmosphere, the skeptics' predictions began to disintegrate when the Nazis launched their first long-distance rockets over London during World War II. The end of the conflict on the battlefield led the way to the technological fight between the US and the Soviet Union, and then the launch of Sputnik, the first artificial satellite to orbit the Earth in 1957. Sputnik was a key milestone to allow Yuri Gagarin to blast off in 1961, when he became the first human to travel to space. A few years later, propelled by the Cold War competition, the US fired back by landing the Apollo 11 lunar module on the moon. Now, despite 600 million people around the world watching it live, many thought it was some sort of Truman Show with conspiracy theories that the footage was NASA-produced films directed by Stanley Kubrick. In 1976, someone even self-published a book called We Never Went to the Moon, claiming to have some secret government documents to support his catchy title. Now, while the book's sales didn't skyrocket, the author spread fake news all over the media. Although 20% of Americans still believe the 1969 landing was a government hoax, space travel didn't stop. The US, Russia, and China have their own functional space stations, and on top of that, 16 countries have been jointly developing the International Space Station. Also, companies like SpaceX, Virgin Galactic, and Blue Origin are working on making flights cheaper and on space tourism. It's going to be hard to claim that space travel is a hoax when you're finally able to go into space yourself. And number 4 is personal computers. Famous for breaking the Enigma code during World War II, Alan Turing is often considered the father of computing machines. When working for the UK National Physical Laboratory in 1946, Turing designed the Automatic Computing Engine, or ACE. This was the world's first electronic computer, able to store programs. While Turing just started up the digital computer era in 1949, someone thought PCs had hit a standby mode. The computer scientist John von Neumann said, "It would appear that we have reached the limits of what is possible to achieve with computer technology." Not only computer power crashed von Neumann's conservative limit, but based on Moore's law, computer processing speed has been growing exponentially for the last 40 years. But von Neumann wasn't the only one who miscalculated his predictions. In 1977, Ken Olson, the founder of the computer company Digital Equipment Corp., stated, "There is no reason anyone would want a computer in their home." Funny enough, that same exact year, Steve Jobs launched the Apple II onto the market. whose sales boomed by the end of the 1970s. By 2012, 80% of Americans had proved Olson wrong. Number 5 is cell phones. In 1973, the Motorola engineer Martin Cooper presented the first portable phone prototype ever during a news conference. The day after its introduction to the world, one of the reporters described the Motorola device as a television set in a wristwatch. Also, just 8 years later, it was actually Cooper himself that said, "Cellular phones will absolutely not replace local wire systems. Even if you project it beyond our lifetimes, it won't be cheap enough." I'm assuming he changed his mind in 2004 when mobile phones overtook landlines in the US. And in 2007, there were plenty of skeptics of the iPhone. Some thought it was too expensive, and others called into question the futuristic features touted by Steve Jobs. Steve Ballmer, the CEO of Microsoft at the time, said there's no chance that the iPhone is going to get any significant market share. Well, I don't know about you, but 23% is actually a pretty good market share just 4 years after its launch. A Bloomberg journalist commented, "It is nothing more than a luxury bauble that will appeal to a few gadget freaks. In terms of its impact in the industry, the iPhone is less relevant." In 2018, Apple's flagship device became the world's best-selling smartphone. The general public didn't miss out on the short-sighted observations either. One guy said, "Apparently none of you guys realize how bad of an idea a touchscreen is on a phone. I foresee some pretty obvious and pretty major problems here." He was right. Nobody realized adding a touchscreen to a phone was a bad idea. That's why every single smartphone today has one. If you look back at the history of these inventions, you may see why it's wise to think twice before doubling down on a knee-jerk reaction. An innovation's early struggles doesn't necessarily mean that they're doomed to fail. And this applies to the green tech innovations that we're seeing emerge today. Take renewables, for instance. They all share a bunch of downsides like fossil fuels reliance, raw materials limitation, and intermittency. Yet technology advancements over the last 10 years have driven down their costs by up to 90%. What about electric cars? You might have heard people complaining about short driving ranges, not having enough charging points, or dirty battery production. Those are all changing and addressable problems. For instance, while lithium extraction is far from being economically and environmentally sustainable right now, companies are commercializing low-impact recycling processes, which means we may need 50% less lithium to make an EV in 10 years. So where should we stand on this? Balance is the way to go. While having an inquisitive mind helps innovators to refine their inventions, we've got to work at keeping our unconscious bias at bay. Stay skeptical, but reasonable. But what do you think? What innovations would you have put on this list? Jump in the comments and let me know. Thanks to all my patrons who get early access and ad-free versions of each video. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.